Hey, welcome back, everybody. It's time to meet our community, the Hispanic business community here in Orange County. Powered by the Orange County Hispanic Chamber of Commerce and Orange County's only community radio station, OC Talk Radio. Streaming live from our studios here at the University of California, Irvine's Beal Applied Innovation Center. With the streaming king himself, John Gutierrez.
Thank you, Paul. Welcome, everybody, to, once again, one of our amazing Our Community podcast shows powered by the Orange County Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. I'm your host, John Gutierrez, here with the Orange County Hispanic Chamber of Commerce as your vice president. We have another special guest today. She's one of our ambassadors here at the chamber. She's also the CEO of OC Credit and Business Builders. She's a co-founder of Tacos El Carpintero and also co-founder of Kingdom Builders. She's a wife, mother, entrepreneur, community volunteer, and a woman of God. Welcome, Erika Garcia.
Hi, Johnny. Thank you. Thank you very much for having me here today.
Yes, thank you for being with us. I know Mexico's playing right now. Viva Mexico.
Viva Mexico.
Viva USA. They Viva moved on, USA. Right? So I know for those of you watching the World Cup, you can still listen in to our show. We appreciate you tuning in. And we're so glad to have you on our show because I know you've been involved with our Hispanic Chamber for a long time, and so we thank you and appreciate all your support.
Absolutely. I've been to many, many chambers, and this is the best. Absolutely.
We're like one big family, right?
Yes. Yeah. Always feeling the love. I remember that when I went to the first event, that's really what I felt, just loved and welcomed. So I love the OC Hispanic Chamber of Commerce.
That's awesome. Thank you. And we'll go into the chamber and all that in a little bit, and we'll talk about some of the things you're doing in the community, obviously your businesses, because you do so much. And I think it's great because here at the Chamber, we focus on entrepreneurs, businesses, obviously corporations, everything we're doing in the community. And there's so much that you're doing in the community. But first and foremost, our audience would like to get to know you. Who's Erika? Where did she grow up? And tell us about a little bit about you if you wish to share some of your family, some hobbies. Tell us a little bit about Erika.
Absolutely. Born in Celaya, Guanajuato. So Mexico.
Guanajuato.
Guanajuato,
I've been there. I've been there one time.
Panza Verde.
Wow. Is that the momias?
That's the momias, yes. Yeah. Funny story with that, though. I came to the U.S. when I was 5, and I had no idea what panza verde or momias were. Not until a few years ago.
What is panza verde?
So they make the leather, and because they specialize in the leather, they have their vest, and since they're doing all the cutting, all the stomach gets green because of the leather. So that's why they call them panzas verdes.
Interesting.
Yes, and I didn't know that, and everybody would tell me, oh, panza verde, and one day I'm like, okay, I was born there, but I have no idea what panza verde means, and that's really what it is. They specialize in a lot of leather in León.
When I graduated from high school, I went to Guanajuato as one of our trips with my family. And we went to Michoacán, Jalisco, where my parents are from, Guadalajara, and we went to Guanajuato, small town, like everything's like really tight. And we went to El Callejón del Beso, right?
Yes.
You know, me being not so tall, I felt very tall because everybody's
everything is tiny.
They're really small people, right? And but it was really cool. It was just, it's a beautiful place. The way the homes are built. Yeah. Right? A lot of brick.
A lot of color. Mm-hmm. A lot of color. I was born there, but I wasn't raised there. So when I would see pictures and I would hear everything about Guanajuato, and then now me just going back as an adult and experiencing it, like, it's absolutely beautiful. But yes, I'm short, so when I'm there, I feel like everything is good.
Yeah, I remember being with my mom, and we went to the Guanajuato church.
Yes.
And there was, as soon as we walked in, there was a lady, like you said, not very tall lady, but she was carrying her child, like on her back, or I can't remember, but she was literally on her knees praying. Yeah. And that for me was just like, wow. And the floor is like bricks, yeah. Right? And she's praying in this beautiful church that's, I think, very famous, like around the world in Guanajuato. Yeah. So Guanajuato, if you haven't been to it, folks, you definitely want to go
San
out and
Miguel
see
de
it.
Allende, absolutely, yes. Beautiful.
Wow.
Yes,
so yes. You moved here when you were 5?
When I was 5, yeah, I moved here.
Do you remember any of that as a kid?
I do, because it was traumatic for me. My mother lived here, and my first 5 years of my life I spent with my grandma. And then one day my mother showed up that I really didn't remember, because, you know, she left us there, not because she wanted to leave us. She wanted something better for us. So she came here to the U.S., made enough money to bring my brother and I here. And at five, she says, okay, you guys are coming with me.
Your mom? By yourself?
Mom. Yes. So then.
Wow.
So then here I am, a spoiled little brat in Mexico with my grandma because I had everything. My mom lived here. And then I come here to the U.S. to share my toys with my sister because now she had two other kids. And that was difficult for me.
The transition.
The transition, yeah.
Interesting.
Coming here to the U.S., not speaking English. It's amazing how things have changed now. Now schools promote for you to be bilingual. But back then, it was actually, I would get punished. I would get detention if I would speak Spanish. So it was difficult. Like I said, I came here. I am a wife. I am a daughter, and I am a mother. I have three siblings.
Okay.
Laura, Eddie, and Caesar.
Shout out to the kids.
Yes, and those are my siblings. And my children, Catherine.
Oh, I'm sorry, siblings.
Siblings. And I'm saying this because family for me is really important.
Yes.
I don't have a big family. I have a very small family. It's my mother, my three brothers, and then my children and my husband. So.
Wow.
Yes, I have three kids. I have Cassandra, and I have my daughter, Catherine, and my son, CJ.
That's right.
Yes.
And so before we go into the family and all that, so growing up, where did you grow up? Did you grow up in what city?
Santana.
Yes,
Santanera. Santana. I'm a Santanera. Yes, wow. Yes.
And what schools did you go to? Do you mind sharing?
Yes, I went to Lathrop. I went
that's
to
my
Century.
Junior high.
Yes,
Lathrop.
I went to Century.
Century, that's
yes.
My alma mater. How do you even know this?
I know.
This is crazy.
And then I ended up in Cesar Chavez because I did not make the right choices and I ended up in Chavez. But I still graduated, so I'm really proud of that.
Interesting. And so how and where did you decide that, hey, I'm going to decide that I want to be an entrepreneur? Because you have that entrepreneur spirit in you, right?
Yeah. I actually didn't discover that until I was 28 years old, living under a rock with a single mother. Literally, I lived under a rock.
Wow.
I didn't know anything. I didn't know there was such thing as hiking. I didn't know that there was network events. I always had this fire in me growing up, and the life I lived was hard. I lived a really hard life, like I'm sure a lot of Latino children with single mothers. And I just knew that everything around me wasn't what I wanted, but I knew there had to be something better. And not until...
What age was that?
I mean, this is like all the way from when I came here to the U.S. all the way up till maybe 28 years old.
Really?
Yeah. I married really young.
You learned at a young age to like the hustle, right?
Yes. You know, just seeing my mother, I love her so much because being a single mother, she struggled a lot and always just trying to give us the best, always working a part-time job, no English. It was hard. We didn't have a car. For us, you know, going to eat, it was like McDonald's. That was like, you know, a good restaurant because we didn't.
Luxury.
It was a luxury.
Yeah, I remember that. It's interesting you bring that up. When we were kids growing up, I think it was eighth grade when my dad's boss invited him to come over for, I think it was maybe for Christmas party for the company. My dad was a landscape worker. And I remember being there and they brought in a box of, I think back then was Burger King, and the kids all had that little crown. And I remember going over to look at this box, and the kids were like, hey, you don't want a cheeseburger? And I'm like, what is that? Right? And they're like, and they all looked at me like I was like from Mars. And they're like, you don't know what a cheeseburger is? And I'm like, no, because we grew up eating frijoles, tortillas, cereal, like home stuff, right? My mom and dad would make birria for the community. They, you know, have extra food from there. And so not knowing what a cheeseburger was or fast food in the 90s or late 80s was unique for us.
Yeah. And hey, at least you had birria. I didn't even know what that was.
We had birria because they would hire my dad to make birria. And then that's kind of how my dad would negotiate. Hey, I'll give it to you at a discount price to make it for you if you give me some like meat to keep. And so that was interesting how my dad would barter, right?
Yeah.
But it just takes me back to the Santana days where we grew up on Highland. Where did you grow up?
I grew up by Bishop in like Main Street, kind of like McFadden area.
No way.
Yeah. And wow. And it's crazy because I didn't live, you know, back in the days. I mean, it was a lot of gangs. It was just bad.
So you didn't grow up too far from where, because I grew up on Highland and Flower.
And Flower, yeah.
I went to that Santa Boys Club as a kid.
I went there too.
No way.
Yes.
This is crazy.
We didn't have, my mom didn't have childcare, so hey.
That Boys and Girls Club was awesome. Yes. In Santa Ana. Like, it saved all of us from being in the streets.
From being
you're
in
right.
The streets.
There was a lot of gangs back then, mm-hmm. A lot of drugs in the neighborhood. So thankfully, hey, shout out to the Boys and Girls Club in Santa Ana.
Yes.
Because they did wonders, I think. They did miracles.
Oh, yeah. I mean, for sure. I know that a lot of things could have happened to me if I was in there after school instead of being home and getting in trouble.
I don't know if you were there when they had it was kind of way back. They had a wood shop there.
Yes, I actually did. A lot of the wood shop. Yes. Oh, my gosh.
Not too many people know about the wood shop. Oh. They had a really cool wood shop in
that
the back.
That was one of my favorites.
No way.
Yes.
That's so funny. Small world. See, you never know who we're going to interview on the show and have so much in common.
So much in common.
Yeah, because
yes.
Lowell Elementary School there. That's where I went to school.
Mm-hmm.
And then now there's a Pico. There's an elementary school they built in front of the Boys Club.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
And there used to be a bunch of apartments.
Okay.
Which had a lot of, unfortunately, yeah. Just drugs mm-hmm. and the whole bad, you know.
What elementary did you go to? I went to Franklin.
So I went to Lowell, and okay. Then I went to Latham.
Oh, late. Okay.
And then I went to Santa Ana. My freshman year, transferred to Century, because Century had just opened.
Okay.
But we're all Santaneros, right?
Yes.
And so you were in your whole life in Santa Ana, pretty much?
Pretty much all my life. When I turned 16, you know, like I said, growing up with my mom, she was in and out of an abusive relationship. And I knew I didn't want any of that. I didn't know what was good, but I just knew I didn't want that. And at the age of 16, I started working. And I remember, you know, where we lived, because obviously she couldn't afford more. It was always either a little studio, waking up with roaches in my mouth. And at 16, it was bad. Like, it was bad. And at 16, when I started working, I looked at my mom and I said, we're moving out of here. So for me, Santa Ana, now as an adult, like, I see how much need, and now I have a different view for Santa Ana. But at first, it was traumatic because everything that I lived in Santa Ana was bad. I mean, I was harassed there. I mean, there was just so much. And like I said, roaches, waking up to roaches in my mouth. At 16, I said, Mom, we have a job and let's get out of here. And
that's, do you remember that first job?
Yeah, I worked at Disneyland.
No way.
Yes,
That's hard to get, right? Like a job at Disneyland.
Yeah, but you know, God has always been good to me. And I've always been around people that either has seen something or just want to help out. And I met this wonderful lady and she said, hey, I could get you in. And got me in.
What an opportunity.
Yes, it was.
It presented itself. You took it.
Yeah, and I learned so much there. I learned so
that
much.
It must have been tough going to Disneyland in Anaheim. That's pretty far.
Yes,
as a 16-year-old.
I would take the bus.
Really? I always like to ask questions about stuff like that because my wife always talks about that when she was young and she lived in Santa Ana and she would take the bus to where Modern Day High School is across the street. She worked at a cleaner's there, and how she would take the bus. And I never experienced that, taking the bus. I would actually walk everywhere. I used to walk from Santa Ana on Highland and Flower all the way to Century. And I just got used to walking a lot. So taking the bus, I mean, there's a lot of people on the bus. Yeah. It's dangerous for a young
kid. When I was living in Santa Ana, I lived on Cypress and Bishop for for half of my life there, and then from there we moved to 17 in Main Street.
Okay.
And that was still going to high school, so I would walk from 17
by Norms. Is that by Norms?
Yes. I would walk from there all the way to Century every day.
No way.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then one day I'm like,
way out there.
That's way out there. And then one day I said, there has to be a better way. And then I discover the bus.
So that 17th and Main Corner, there was a flower shop there for mm-hmm. many years. Yeah. My wife worked at that flower shop.
No way.
Yeah, because every time we go by there, she reminds me. Remember, aww, I used to work, and now it's actually now going to be a Farmers Merchant Bank. We're actually going to be doing the ribbon cutting and the grand opening for it in the next couple months.
Oh.
They're building a brand new bank there. But so let's take you back to, so as you transition into adulthood, at what point, job-wise, did you say to yourself, like, I want to be an entrepreneur? Because, I mean, we're going to go into some of this stuff here. I mean, you own a credit business, right?
Yes.
You recently started Tacos El Carpintero, which, by the way, they're amazing tacos. They were at our festival recently and just killed it.
Not because I make them, but they are good.
So if you're looking for a taquero, right here.
Yes.
Right? They have a beautiful setup. They have tons of, like, salsas, right?
Yes.
I like the whole setup.
Thank you. And you know what? So we've been going to Temecula every Tuesday at the Temecula Wine and Beer Garden. And right now we are known as the best tacos in Temecula.
What?
Yes. Give it up.
Best tacos in Temecula right here.
Yes, yes.
And that's good because you're not far from... It's a really big booming area there. Yeah. The winery, mm-hmm. obviously the casinos are out. The casinos out there, so it's a great place to be involved as far as an entrepreneur, right?
Yes.
As a small business growing.
Yes.
What has been some of the challenges you face or are facing right now, launching that business?
Honestly, I haven't had any.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
I think this was something that it was really sent from up above, and God just really has opened up, like, all the doors.
But I know your husband has a background in that industry, right?
He does, yes.
His family.
So he grew up in León, and he, all his family have either taco restaurants or they've been in the taco business. So he grew up with that. So this is not new to us.
Oh, that's great.
It's just he grew up with it, and it's something that we always wanted to do as a family, open up a restaurant. And then, you know, all the businesses that we have, they've never been, oh, one day I said I want to do this. No, they've just been either because of need, either just a desire that I've had, and then it just happened. So one day we're talking and we're like, hey, you know, what if we were to, like, open up a taco business? And we opened up a taco business, and it's been great. We have not had any challenges for that business yet, but I really think because it's really God's behind it all.
Tell everybody, I know you specialize in certain particular, I mean, you do all tacos, but what is that one? Is it lomo, right?
It's lomo, yes. That is our house. So now we call it El Carpintero, our house special. We figure, you know, we kept saying lomo, lomo, and a lot of people don't know what lomo is, and we had to sit there and try
what
to explain.
What is lomo in English?
So lomo, it's pork shoulder.
Okay.
It's pork shoulder, and we cook that for anywhere, it cooks anywhere between 15 to 20 hours.
So it's slowly cooks.
Yes.
So it's almost like birria, because birria,
like birria
cooks really slow, and it just falls apart.
Yes.
So, oh man, I'm getting hungry just thinking about this.
You know, Paul? Good.
So Paul's like, why didn't you bring some of those tacos? Look at Paul, our producer over here. She's like...
So the difference between birria and lomo is the birria, you take, it's a lot of it in the broth, what's good.
Okay.
This is the actual meat, the flavors in the meat, not in the broth.
Wow.
So
I know is that our recent festival that you were at with us, our Fight Cancer Foundation fundraiser we did, you had a line of people for hours and hours. And then at nighttime, I remember you making those really cool, like, nachos. They're like little mini nachos.
Mini nachos,
yeah.
Yes,
yeah,
with lomo.
You put lomo, you put the chips, and then you had like a special sauce on top.
Yes,
right?
That chipotle sauce.
That chipotle sauce. Oh, Paul, you missed out, Paul. Look at Paul's face over there. He's like, come on, man, bring me stuff.
I'm getting hungry just listening to this, guys. Well, you're teasing me here.
I know, I know. So for those of you that are looking for, so you would do those tacos and also maybe like the little nachos or other
yes,
stuff?
Yes, so we do that. We do nachos. I mean, we have a full menu. We have nachos. We do loaded potatoes, quesadillas. So it's not just the tacos.
That's good to know, because a lot of people hear taquero and they think, oh, they're just going to come make tacos, right?
Yeah.
No, there's other stuff.
There we have other stuff, yeah.
Oh, mm-hmm. and then how about, I think you also have drinks, right?
We do drinks, you know, the aguas frescas. Right now, with the cold season, we do ponche. And again, not because I do it, but I make really good ponche.
So everybody listening, what is ponche? Because I know what ponche is,
ponche,
but let's explain
the
that.
The best way that I could describe it, it's like a hot sangria.
Oh,
yeah. So
okay.
Ponche, it's a hot drink that is done with just different fruits. It has cinnamon, apples. I put cranberries, jamaica, tamarindo.
And you cook it and ferment it?
And then you cook it and ferment it, yeah. And it basically cooks for at least 3 hours, the same.
So it's a nice warm, you know, juice that is good and soothing for the cold weather
right
now.
For the cold weather, yes. And, you know, some people like to add some rum, some tequila.
I'm sure Paul doesn't like that. Right, Paul?
No. None of that for me, thank you.
Mr. Michigan over there, it's freezing.
What I meant to say is just give me the rum and the tequila and all that other stuff, right?
Wow, that is awesome. So aside from the taco business you just launched, I also know that you have Kingdom Builders.
Kingdom Builders,
what is Kingdom Builders?
Kingdom Builders, that is our construction company that my husband and I have. And we do, you know, all kinds of construction. And then during the Christmas season, we do Christmas light installations as well.
Yes.
Yes.
So those of you listening that need Christmas lights, you got to call Erika. She's actually going to be out in our house doing our lights tonight.
Yes.
Which, by the way, thank you, because I'm scared of heights. And and this woman climbs up. Like, I didn't know it was you that did it. We were just talking about this before the show. I didn't know that you climbed up to, like, these rooftops. And,
yes.
And you're, like, hanging there like Spider-Man.
Well, I had no idea that I liked the heights so much until... You know, I went up there to one roof, and my husband, he's probably going to hate me for this.
Don't say it. Don't say it.
I won't say it. Okay, he knows. But anyway,
he prefers to stay doing the lights at the bottom.
At the bottom, yes. He's really good at that. Yeah. So I go up on a roof, and when I'm up there, I just feel free.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you, like, stand up there on top of the house and just kind of look around at the view?
All the time.
Really?
Yeah. I just go up there and just feeling the breeze.
You know
just...
what would happen with me? I'd be shivering. I'd be like,
no.
I need to get down. Paul, I don't know, but you're the same way. I don't like heights.
I think it was meant to be a bird or something. The higher, the better.
She was saying before the show, maybe I shouldn't pipe up and say this, but she said when she gets stressed, she goes up on the roof. It's like I grew up with the old Drifter song, Up on the Roof, you know.
On the roof, yeah.
She goes up on the roof to get away. I can't imagine climbing up on a roof to get away. I want to get away from the roof.
No, it's an amazing feeling. So if you've never tried it, I really highly encourage you to do it.
Well, that's awesome that you like to do that. Now, tell us a bit about also the credit and business builders, because that's huge.
Yeah.
I know a lot of people in the real estate industry right now, it's a roller coaster, right? And so you help people fix their credit, right?
Yes.
So that is huge, right? Tell everybody a little bit about what you do there.
Yeah. So credit, our credit business, it started a few years back. I was in the insurance world, and I don't know, just, you know, insurance is amazing, but it doesn't change people's lives. And I wanted to do something that changed people's lives, and credit changes people's lives.
It's true.
I mean, it is amazing right now. You know, 10 years ago, you didn't need good credit to rent a little house in the back. You need good credit to even rent a room now.
Yeah.
So definitely it does changes people's lives, and it's a calling that I have and I've been doing. So we do two things. We do credit repair and we do debt settlement. Most companies, for you guys that don't know, either they specialize in credit repair or they specialize in a debt settlement.
Yes.
One works with the bureaus and one works with the companies. We do both.
Yes.
So basically we build people's credit, people that have had, you know, a loss or just something traumatic with their credit, we help them rebuild it, or people that have not had credit, we help them build credit.
You know what's interesting is credit obviously comes from the word credibility, right? And today I hear a lot of companies, before they hire you, they're actually checking people's credit.
Yep.
Because they're going to see the kind of credibility or history you have as a mm-hmm. person.
Yeah.
Ethically, right? Do you pay your bills on time?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I think a lot of people don't realize that or don't know that.
Well, there's one other thing that people are checking for now before they get married. They're checking the other person's credit. I actually had a client that came to me. She was going to get married and said, I do not want to have bad credit when I moved in with my fiance, because I don't want that bad, you know, just that bad that I've been carrying, and I want to fix it. And she was the first one. Then from there, I had other people, same thing. You know, they're checking the other person's credit. It's so important. If you're going to marry someone, eventually you want to buy a house, but the other one has bad credit, you can't.
It's a funny story. We were actually at Home Depot this weekend talking about credit. And you walk up there and we're about to buy this Christmas tree, right? It's like my wife wanted the really nice one. We're like, you know what? Let's get for the first time one that's not a real tree, because we like to turn on the heater. I do during the winter time. And my wife's like, it's going to dry the real tree that we have, right? Because it's going to dry it up pretty soon. So we said, okay, let's go to Home Depot and buy one of these trees, because my sister has one. And as we walk up, the lady says to my wife, do you want to apply for a credit card? And my wife's like, no, we're okay. And she's like, well, the gentleman actually says, it's, you know, let's just try it out. My wife's like, okay, fine, let's just do it. And she's been working on building her credit, right? And so have I. And so I looked at her and I said, okay, we'll see what they say. And it comes back, and they give her this little paper, and she says, "Oh, they gave us $500, you know, credit line here at Home Depot." And I'm like, "Oh, that's great." And the man looks at it and he goes, "Oh no, that's $5,000." And we were like, "Wow," because she'd been working really hard on fixing her credit, and I have too. And I was so proud of her. Yep. I said, "Honey, this is awesome that you've been working on your credit, and they gave you a $5,000 credit limit." And so now the tree went on the, because they said, "Oh, we're going to just put it there." And so it was just interesting how hard work pays off.
Oh, most definitely. And, right? You know, I always share this story with people, how important credit is, especially I love to teach our young generation, because I feel like I would be in another place if I would have known the importance of credit and just financial literacy, period, growing up. Obviously, my mom didn't know, so I didn't know, and I learned it older. So I always try to teach, you know, like my daughter and anyone that's just young. But I always teach them this, and it is more valuable and so much more important to have good credit than $350,000 in your bank account. Now, I say that because I had one client that came to me with a score of 470. Wow. And wanted to buy a house. He had $350,000 in his bank account. He said, "I want to buy a house," and he couldn't.
Yeah.
Now, I've had other people that have 800 and have zero money to buy a house. Yeah. So it's so much more important.
Finding the balance, right? Yeah. Well, I know there's little tricks, and I don't want to give away all the tricks. You got to call Erica. But little tricks like, instead of using your debit card, use your little credit card when you start off, that may be 300, 500. And then now with apps on your phone, it's so easy to make a payment, right?
Yes.
So as soon as you use it, you pay it off. And so what it does, it helps build your credit as opposed to using your own debit card, right? Which gives you no credit.
Yeah. But you have to also watch out for that, because some people just don't know how to manage it, and that's where they just lose control.
Like overspend,
yes.
A certain percentage that you shouldn't be spending.
So I'm going to share this with you guys.
Don't give the tricks.
You got to
call Erica.
Call me then.
You got to call Erica. Don't give him all the tricks.
Okay, I was going to, but he said no. Sorry, guys. You guys got to call me.
You got to call Erica. You got to get a hold of her. How do they reach you, Erica? Because I know we only have a few minutes. Paul's giving me the stinky eye already. He's like, "You only got 2 minutes left." So how do they get a hold of you?
All social media platforms, OC Biz Builders, or you could find me just with my name, Erika Garcia.
Okay. Erika with the K.
With a K, yes. Erika with a K. Yeah. You could also call me. Is it okay to get my number?
That's up to you. or an email? You want to share an email?
Yeah, you could email me at ocbizbuilders.com. But sorry. No. That was my website. ocbizbuilders@gmail.com. The website as well. You could do ocbizbuilders.com.
That's good. The website's good because they can go there, research, and they can send you a message there, right?
Yes.
I think it's so critical that if you need help, and everybody does at some point, building that credit, it's huge, like you said, to buy a property, to buy a car, your interest rates, you save so much more money, right?
Oh, yes.
So definitely reach out to Erica for that. And of course, you know, continue all success with also Tacos El Carpintero.
Thank you.
Kingdom
Yes.
Builders. And shout out to the husband and the kids.
Yes.
Right? Because we know you are a wife, a mother, an entrepreneur.
He's the better half.
Volunteer, and a woman of God.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for being on the show. And thank you so much for becoming one of our ambassadors at the Orange County Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. We really appreciate that. Of course, with Carol Robles and the whole team and Nadia and everybody. Thank you so much for that.
No, absolutely. I'm super excited about that. I wanted to do it since before COVID, and then COVID hit and paused everybody's world. But hey, I'm here to give it all.
Well, folks, tune in next week again as we have another special guest. Erika Garcia, thank you so much for being on the show today.
No, thank you so much for having me here.
I know it goes by so fast.
It does.
It's a 30-minute show. We try to hit all the areas.
I had so much to just give, but hey, it's okay. We always, whatever comes out, it's what it's supposed to.
Next time, you have to bring tacos, right, Paul?
She can come back anytime if she brings tacos.
Okay, just let me know when. I'll bring the lomo.
Well, folks, there you have it. Erika Garcia, one of our ambassadors here at the Orange County Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. Thank you for tuning in to our community podcast show powered by the Orange County Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. Don't forget, December 15th is our annual toy drive. It's only a few weeks away. Tune in to that event and, of course, come out and support and bring toys for our local community kids. Paul, thank you so much. And OC Talk Radio, take it away.
Well, there you have it. That doesn't make you want to come back and hear more. I don't know what will.
as we meet our community, the Hispanic business community here in Orange County, powered by the Orange County Hispanic Chamber of Commerce and Orange County's only community radio station, OC Talk Radio, streaming live from our studios here at the University of California, Irvine's Beal Applied Innovation Center.